What I'd like to do is I'd like to prove that if you've got two groups, let's call them G and H. Let's assume G is isomorphic to H, but H is not necessarily a subgroup of G. So I'm assuming that this is true. I want to show that this implies that the group of automorphisms of G is isomorphic to the group of automorphisms of H. You've got two isomorphic groups. That implies that the corresponding groups of automorphisms are also isomorphic. As a reminder, before I think about proving this, an important reminder, remember that if you've got a true statement, and this is a true statement, a true implication, its contrapositive will also be true, where you switch these around and negate them. If you know that the group of automorphisms of G and H are not isomorphic, that would imply G and H themselves are not isomorphic. And that could be a useful thing if you recall from the reading in chapter 6 about isomorphisms, is it's easier to prove groups are not isomorphic than it is to prove they're isomorphic. You just need to find properties that the two groups don't share. In this case, if we happen to somehow know that these groups of automorphisms are not isomorphic, that'll mean the original groups themselves are not isomorphic. Okay, maybe you can't really imagine a situation where this would be easier to figure out than that, but yeah, there could be some situations like that. But what's the idea of the proof? Let's problem solve here. Okay, we're assuming G is isomorphic to H. What does that mean? Always ask yourself, what does that mean? That means, by definition, there exists an isomorphism phi from G to H. Okay, great. What do I know about that? I know it's one-to-one onto an operation preserving. You can say those kinds of things to yourself in your mind. Are those thoughts helpful? Sometimes not. What do we want to do? We must show. Let's do a we must show. We must show aut of G is isomorphic to aut of H. In other words, i.e., show there exists an isomorphism from aut of G to aut of H. What should I call it? Oh, what's the next Greek letter we use, like using here? How about a psi? So pretty. Psi from aut of G to aut of H. All right, now, so this is kind of like the easy part of the scratch work, right? You write these things down, you like get a cup of coffee, take a drink, stare at it, and you're like, I don't know what to do. Let me go watch TV. Come back an hour later, look at it, it's still there. Still don't know what to do, right? You've experienced this kind of thing. So what do you do? It's not clear. This is the hardest part. Well, first thing, before we realize we're going to have an isomorphism here, can we even come up with a mapping? Can we even come up with a function from aut of G to aut of H? I have to understand what it would mean to come up with such a mapping. Well, what are the elements of aut of G and aut of H? The elements of aut of G are automorphisms of G. Isomorphisms from G to itself. I've got to map an arbitrary isomorphism from G to itself to an isomorphism from H to itself. How in the world can you do such a thing? This has got to be relevant somehow. That must be relevant. I mean, that's what we're assuming. That's another key you want to look for is how can you use what you're assuming? Maybe a diagram would help. What kind of diagram? Well, I've got the phi in here. An automorphism of G is an isomorphism from G to itself. Maybe I should draw an arrow that goes kind of around and back to G itself like that. What should I call an arbitrary automorphism of G? I don't know, alpha? It would be, by the way, a permutation as well. Not our typical kinds of permutations that we've been thinking about, but an automorphism of a group is a permutation of that group because it's a one-to-one and onto mapping from the group to itself. But we don't have to think about that. There's an arbitrary automorphism of G. How do I use this picture, so to speak, to create, to construct an automorphism of H, an isomorphism from H to itself, a mapping from H to itself? Maybe go backwards around and back? Can we do that? If we went this way, I guess we'd be using phi inverse. And then around, using alpha, using the given arbitrary alpha, and then back using phi. Maybe what we want is we want psi to map alpha, this arbitrary automorphism of G, in other words, isomorphism of G to itself, to another function that maps H to itself. Phi inverse would be the first function that you apply in this mapping, then alpha, then phi. So remember, you go from right to left with function composition. I'd have to write that as phi compose alpha compose phi inverse. Kind of looks like conjugation, doesn't it? Inner automorphisms, kind of a similar formula. Maybe this is the formula for psi. Realize what we're doing here. Always remind yourself, we're taking an arbitrary function alpha and mapping it to another function using another function. Psi is a function of functions. You're actually kind of familiar with functions of functions from your past. Okay, a side comment here, right? Like the derivative operator. Call it ddx takes a function f of x and maps it to its derivative. In calculus, we just thought of these as two different symbols for the derivative, but you could think of this as a mapping. You could think of this of ddx as a function that maps functions to functions. It's a different kind of function. F of x and f prime of x take real number inputs and give you real number outputs. ddx takes function inputs and gives you function outputs. You should have thought about that in linear algebra as well, like with vector spaces, thinking about these as being elements of vector spaces, function spaces. You ever talk about this set in linear algebra? CAB. What's that? That's the vector space of all continuous functions defined in the closed interval from A to B. The elements of this are functions. Just a little aside that you have thought about these kinds of things before. But is this mapping from here to here? It certainly is a mapping from here to here. Is it one-to-one onto an operation preserver? Let's do a little bit of problem solving for that. Is it one-to-one? One-to-one question mark? If I assume psi of alpha equals psi of beta, does that imply alpha equals beta as functions? What's the formula for psi? Psi of alpha, looking up here, is going to be phi compose alpha compose phi inverse. Psi of beta is going to be phi compose beta compose phi inverse. These are equal functions. They have equal outputs for all inputs. I guess the inputs would be in H, because the first function there on the right is phi inverse. We're trying to show alpha equals beta. Now, actually, last time we talked about doing this by showing that they have the same outputs for every input. But I think here we can do it more simply. Effectively, think of these as group elements and do cancellation. Left cancellation implies alpha phi inverse equals beta phi inverse. And right cancellation implies alpha equals beta. It's not quite the same thing as group cancellation because these functions are not all in the same group of automorphisms, for example. In fact, phi and phi inverse themselves are not automorphisms because they're mapping from distinct groups, not a group to itself. But this is something that can be proved for function composition as well. I won't go into details. You can do this. You can effectively left cancel and you can right cancel. And that would be enough to prove that it's one-to-one. Is it on to? Give me an arbitrary what? Give me an arbitrary automorphism of H, mapping H to itself. Is there an automorphism in G that gets mapped to that automorphism of H? Should I use a different Greek letter? How about Xi? Let Xi be an automorphism of H. Does there exist an automorphism of G such that psi of alpha equals Xi? Do problem solving. That would be equivalent by the formula for psi to phi alpha phi inverse equaling C. Right, look at the formula for psi. I'm wondering, can I solve for alpha? Sure. Apply phi inverse to both sides on the left. This would be equivalent to alpha phi inverse equals phi inverse C. And apply phi to both sides on the right. This would be equivalent to alpha equals phi inverse xi phi. And effectively, what I've done here is I've found the inverse function of psi. Sort of reverse where phi and phi inverse are in this formula. You'd have to prove this is an automorphism of G. You'd have to prove it's one-to-one and onto an operation preserving if you were going to really do this rigorously right now, which I'm not wanting to do quite yet. So this is problem solving. This is not the finished proof. The key would be really showing it's operation preserving. Then it's inverse function. If it's one-to-one and onto, its inverse function would exist, and that would be, I mean, you could prove this is operation preserving as well. The inverse function of psi here, I meant to say. Is it operation preserving? I have to compare psi of alpha beta with psi of alpha psi of beta. Are these the same thing? Once again, the formula for psi, psi of alpha is phi times alpha times phi inverse. So this is phi times alpha beta times phi inverse. When I say times here, I really mean compose function composition. On the other line, phi of alpha is, or psi of alpha is phi compose alpha compose phi inverse, and psi of beta is phi compose beta compose phi inverse. Seems like we've done this kind of thing before. Just rearrange parentheses. And that's an epsilon, that's an identity mapping. Might be good to emphasize what identity mapping. There are different identity mappings because there are different domains that the mapping could have. It's phi inverse compose phi, meaning work from right to left here. Phi gets applied first and phi inverse. Going back up to this picture, that means it's the identity mapping of G, not H. You might call this epsilon sub G. But when you do compose epsilon with any of these other mappings, it goes away effectively. It's the identity. This simplifies to the same thing. Okay, so once again, I emphasize, all this is very abstract. It's easy to get confused about what in the world you're doing. But as far as actually doing it, once you get used to the abstraction, it's kind of like the only thing you can do. And amazingly, it works. It's kind of almost like it's set up to work. Abstract math is hard because it's abstract. But once you get used to the abstraction, at least in textbooks, it's kind of set up to work. Now, being in textbooks is different than discovering this in the first place, right? Who was the first person to think of this kind of thing? That's hard to imagine. Abstract math is also hard because it's hard to come up, be the first person to come up with it in the first place. But it is powerful. It is a powerful tool. This conceivably could be a powerful tool for proving two groups are not isomorphic, G and H. If you could prove there are groups of automorphisms are not isomorphic, then you would know that the groups themselves are not isomorphic. This conceivably could be a very powerful tool. And it is.